Mike D actually spends time with Donny Osmond. I mean, we might goof around a little bit, but these two will be up at 4 in the morning freebasing like maniacs.
Working on dance steps, basing, all kinds of shit like that.
Rick Rubin always claimed that his favourite bands were the Washington DC go-go collective Trouble Funk and Australian hard rock monsters AC/DC, and his vision for Def Jam was to combine the best elements of the two. He quickly became a sort of fourth beastie, acting as a live DJ on stage and producing their records. The first two Def Jam singles, Rock Hard and She's On It, were primitive but catchy blends of obnoxious rap with sampled metal riffs. By this time, the trio had transformed fully from black-clad punks into baseball-capped b-boys, complete with appropriate names. Diamond became Mike D, Yauch was MCA, and Horowitz created the persona of King Ad Rock. They also played up a brand of cartoonish bad behaviour, merging adolescent sexism with beer-throwing and swearing. A few years later, this would be written off under the heading New Laddism, but in the too cool 80s, this was seriously bad news. She's On It brought the Beasties to the attention of Madonna, then at the height of her fame as pop star and sex symbol. Perhaps recognising kindred spirits, who could mix a controversial image with infectious pop sounds, she took the trio on as a support act for her Like a Virgin tour in 1985. Much of Ms. Ciccone's fanbase at the time consisted of teenage girls, and the Beasties' foul-mouthed, crotch-grabbing antics weren't really what was considered suitable at the time. But Madonna held out against record company pressure to keep them on board. They were kindred spirits after all, and in a few years she would be generating just as much media controversy with projects such as the Like a Prayer video and the Sex book. Meanwhile, Rubin and the Beasties were working on the band's debut album. Licensed to Ill was an uproarious piss-take of oafish adolescence, set off by the signature track Fight for Your Right to Party. It became the fastest-selling debut album in the history of Def Jam's parent company, Columbia Records, and the first rap album to reach the top spot on the American charts. Along with Run DMC's Raising Hell, released a few months before, it was final proof that hip-hop could succeed as more than a singles-based genre. The cover encapsulated what the Beasties were all about. A sleek aircraft proudly carries the band's logo on the tail fin, but when the gatefold is opened up, the plane is revealed to have crashed into a cliff face. The strutting machismo of hip-hop is neatly punctured, but you have to be quick to spot it. Not everyone was taken with the Beastie's long play and debut. Accusations of sexism came thick and fast, especially over the track Girls, although the cheesy Casio organ backing might have hinted to more open-minded critics that a certain level of irony was at work. Adam Yauch's claim that the working title for the record had been Don't Be a Faggot caused uproar in the gay community. But it wasn't so much that any particular social group was under attack. It was more the atmosphere of dumbass self-indulgence that grated with some listeners. John Bonham's drum break from Led Zeppelin's When the Levee Breaks was almost a hip-hop cliché. But when the Beasties used it on Rhyming and Stealing, it was seen as a homage to the drugged-up, groupie-abusing hard rock lifestyle that Led Zepp personified through the 1970s. Fight for Your Right soon became an anthem for beard-up student parties, with unattractive young men punching the air in dumb celebration of the sort of arrogant hedonism the band was satirizing. Whatever their true intentions, these accusations would come back to haunt the band over a decade later. Mike claimed that it was just the sound of the three of us goofing off, but the time would soon come when they'd be held responsible for their adolescent excesses. As it stood, the New York alternative newspaper, The Village Voice, probably summed up the prevailing mood when it headlined the review of Licensed to Ill as Three Jerks Make a Masterpiece. If the music wasn't enough to upset people, Mike's fashion sense caused even more ructions. He'd taken to wearing a Volkswagen badge on a chain in ironic emulation of the Mercedes emblems sported by black rappers. Beastie fans in the States and beyond took to prizing the badges off cars, causing Volkswagen to offer a free VW symbol to anyone who applied for one. The fact that the replacement badges were about one third of the size of real ones made them an object of derision amongst serious BC acolytes, and hapless car owners had to put up with vandalised radiators for several more months. But the controversy really kicked in when the Beasties toured Europe. Part of the tabloid frenzy was engineered as a publicity stunt, much as Michael McLaren had insured for the Sex Pistols a decade before, but it had repercussions beyond the control of Def Jam. A fabricated story that Horowitz had poked fun at disabled children in Switzerland erupted in the Daily Mirror, and The Sun's Gary Bushell declared that the band's appearance at Brixton was going to provoke a full-scale race riot. Various Tory MPs argued for the band's deportation, especially when it became known that the stage set included caged dancing girls and a large hydraulic penis. To begin with, the trouble existed only in the frazzled minds of a few media hacks. But when the Beasties reached Liverpool, things turned serious. Spurred on by the tabloid hysteria, the audience pelted the band with bottles and cans, and the gig was cut short after three songs. But it wasn't over, as one woman complained to police that she'd been on the receiving end of a can that Horowitz had baseball batted back into the crowd. Adrock was charged and held in the cells overnight, while his bandmates went back to New York, but the case was eventually dropped. The furore surrounding the Beasties had many far-reaching effects. Licensed to Ill was the single most important release in the phenomenon that saw hip-hop become the preferred music of hundreds of thousands of teenagers. Just as the Rolling Stones and the Yardbirds had led fans to the music of Muddy Waters and Howling Wolf, so the kids who stole VW badges were more receptive to Public Enemy and NWA, and later to the likes of Tupac and Notorious B.I.G. The received wisdom, especially in the USA, that musical taste was strictly divided on racial lines, was shot to pieces. The Beasties also brought bad behaviour and rebellion back to the heart of rock and roll. Not since the glory days of the Sex Pistols had so much press coverage been given to a band simply living out the rock lifestyle. Granted, much of it was overstated by the band's publicists, and there were some incidents that were simply cooked up in the fertile brains of tabloid hacks. But there's no doubt that the Beasties took a sort of anarchistic delight in pushing the boundaries of good taste. Their obnoxious hijinks would reverberate through bands like the Happy Mondays and magazines like Loaded for years after the Beasties themselves had moved on. Mike D, Ad Rock and MCA were now international stars, and the album was selling around the world, but they must have asked themselves whether the aggravation was worth it. What happened next would, in a different way, be just as painful.